Hey guys, it's Penny again. Listen, I have decided, I've been listening to so many people offering different suggestions for people that are self-quarantined, indoors, not used to this, and so many interesting ideas going on out there. And of course, the rampant fear and anxiety and stress that's happening from not having a clue about our future. So I just wanted to let you know that I have some advice, because as a retina detachment survivor and macular hole survivor, first of all, I want to make you feel a little bit better, because, you know, when the doctor told me that, first of all, she did give me a choice. I mean, this is the thing. We all have choice, right? We still have choice. I don't care how much they take stuff away from us. There's a choice we all have. And I'm going to tell you about that in just a minute. But I want to describe for you just a little bit why this is not so hard for me, okay? So my very first retina detachment, I knew something bad had happened, and I didn't know how bad. And when I got there, I was on the outside window of them being able to have a success at all from this detachment. And the physician had worked really hard to rearrange things with the hospital to get me into surgery immediately. And so she handed me this piece of paper and she says, okay, you have to sign this piece of paper. If you don't do it, I can't do surgery and you're going to go blind. That was like this long thing, and I couldn't read it anyway. So I was like, okay. So I signed, and she didn't tell me anything about surgery or anything. So I do the surgery. It's a very, 4.5 hours. She basically rebuilt my eye. We're not going to go into all that detail, but she did end up sewing a nice little plastic buckle that's still in that eyeball. And then after she did her part, it was up to me to go home and make sure I chose to do what she told me to do. Now, what she told me to do was to stay home for 14 days with laying on my side, my left side to be exact, with my nose pointed always down toward the floor. And I was allowed to get up 5 minutes an hour, but my nose had to be pointed toward the ground all that time. And so I had a choice during that time. I could either go to the bathroom, or I could get something to drink, or I could eat something. That was my choice. Now, or that was my instructions anyway. I could have ignored them, but she explained that if I didn't do what she told me to do, the potential of the outcome of all this would be that I would have a very unknown about whether or not I would see. I mean, it was an unknown anyway. We didn't know till I went through all this and took all this stuff off. But I decided it was kind of important to be able to see, you know, it was because I'd already been lost my job and all this other stuff. So I decided maybe I would listen to her and do that. So let me tell you what it's like, because back then, we didn't have cell phones other than these little tiny flippy things that didn't have a screen or anything on it. That's all that was available. And we didn't have iPads. We didn't have the kind of computers we got now. We didn't have all of that connective kind of stuff. I couldn't read a book. How are you going to read with your nose down? And I wasn't supposed to be moving my eyes around anyway, so that was not an option. And I didn't have many choices but to be alone with me and my thoughts. And so right before all this happened, what's really interesting is when I was very first diagnosed, I went into this little resale shop in our town, and there was this book there. Now, I'd never been in the book section. I walked into the book section, not knowing what I was doing, and my arm just reached out, pulled this book out, and at the top of that page was the word eyes. And here's what it said. Imperfect vision. Correspondences. Fear. Suspicion, seeing obstacles, watching for unhappy events to come to pass, living in the past or the future, not living in the now. Okay, so that fear thing, that right? So I knew fear was my enemy. This was the big enemy because I was a worrier. I was afraid of everything. It was bad. It was bad. So rather than get really into the whole details, I knew that when I thought about the past, was upset about what had happened, or when I was thinking about the future, that was totally unknown, I would go into fear or anger or frustration or worry or anxiety, and then I would get angry, and then I get mad at somebody, and wasn't a pretty picture. So I decided that I was going to do everything I could with my thoughts, because I could control my thoughts and I could control how I felt. And what I did about staying present in the now, okay? So first of all, I had to get kind of creative because, you know, trying to figure out ways to keep your head propped up and keep you from going to sleep and falling on your back and doing the things I wasn't supposed to do. So I slept all the time for 14 days on the sofa with my back to the sofa so I didn't turn over. But I still had to figure out, how am I going to prop myself up so I don't fall forward on the sofa? So this was not a fun little experience, but I'm here to tell you that your biggest enemy right now, because the past is over, we can't do anything about it. What's happening now is all we can control. We cannot do anything about the future. And when I say we can control what's happening now, you have a choice right where you are. You can keep your thoughts right here, focused on something that you can do creative, and do everything you can every time your thoughts get into fear or worry or thinking about what you lost or thinking about what's going to happen in the future that's totally unknown. You have no clue. I didn't have a clue. My future turned out to be so much better than I ever imagined. Now, that wouldn't be easy getting from where I was to there. Not diminishing that. It wasn't easy because I had a lot of changes I had to make in me and my habits and stuff. But I'm telling you, you got it lucky, guys. I mean, you probably can move around in your apartment, you know, or your house or whatever. Probably you have a smartphone. Probably you have a computer or an iPad. You have television to watch. You can read books. You can do a lot of things here. But don't let yourself get caught into fear, because when you're there, that's when you act irrationally and you do stupid things and you say things to people you wish you hadn't said, and it's just not pretty. Now, since you don't have the restriction that I did, here's something else I would recommend, is find a way, and I think one of the best is writing stuff down, to get whatever's going on in here out in a constructive way. And if you write it on paper and you take a look at it and you figure out, well, what are the feelings I'm having about this situation? I can't do anything about the situation if you keep focusing on this thing that's caused all this. then all you do is make that worse. It just doesn't get any better. So get that out there and then just kind of get quiet and sit with yourself and ask, well, this is what I'm feeling. I mean, this is just what I'm feeling, and it's okay for me to let that out. And I would like to let that out so I could feel better. I don't want to be feeling afraid, and I don't want to feel angry, and I don't want to feel frustrated, and I don't want to feel anxious. I don't want to feel isolated. I don't want that. What I do want is I want to feel safe. I want to feel loved. I want to know everything's going to be okay. Those are the kinds of things. So focusing on things that make us happier, make us feel better, putting on some music. Now, if you watch movies or you get on the internet, which I think is just fine, just don't focus on all that stuff that's going to make you feel bad. It's not worth it. It just makes things worse. So let's focus on some of the things that are really positive that make you feel good. Like, I love looking at little videos about animals. They always make me happy. I always like, you know, heartwarming things when somebody does something nice for somebody, because what you want to do is make your heart feel good. That's really what you want to do. And so, I don't know. Those are just some ideas from a gal who's survived having to do that. First time, it was my nose down. Second time, I got lucky. That time, the detachment was up high. So, because what they do is, like, they fill your, after they do all that stuff that they do, they've taken your vitreous out and they put this gas bubble in, you know, you hear about people like that. Well, that acts like a compression bandage. And so it has to stay in place in the right location where the injury took place, long enough for the retina to hopefully actually form some scar tissue so it can hold the retina back up there so you can see again somewhat. So my second one, I got lucky. I got to sit up in a chair and look straight forward. I just had to pad myself so I didn't move my head. Or drop it down. So I slept in a chair sitting straight for that many days. Now, the macular hole was a little bit more challenging, and I didn't think I was going to make it through that one because I had to be face down. And that was a whole different story. We won't go into that. But anyway, guys, this really is so much easier than mine was. So I thought you might enjoy a little bit of humor today and pass along some of my advice. Yeah, if it helps, great. If it doesn't, at least I offered it to you and got you distracted just a little bit. Love you guys. I hope you have a really good day.